الحمد لله الحمد لله رب العالمين نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه من يهد الله فهو المهتدي ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له هو الأول والآخر هو الظاهر والباطن وهو بكل شيء عليم ونشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمدًا عبد الله ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وحبيبه إمام المرسلين وصفوة خلق الله والناس أجمعين ورضي الله تبارك وتعالى عن الصحابة المكرمين وعن التابعين وتابع التابعين إلى يوم الدين أما بعد عباد الله اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون واعتصموا بحبل الله جميعا ولا تفرقوا واذكروا نعمة الله عليكم إذ كنتم أعداء فألف بين قلوبكم فأصبحتم بنعمته إخوانا Dear brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته And all praise are due to Allah and we bear witness that there is no God but Allah Muhammad is his servant and messenger Peace, blessing and mercy of Allah be upon him and the Abundant Prophets before Prophet Muhammad and the followers until the Day of Judgment. Dear brothers and sisters, today inshallah we will be talking about the Fariqah of Hajj. Last Saturday night we discussed some about that Fariqah. However, the majority of you were not attending. And I see that it is very important that you know what we meant to say. Hopefully and hoping and praying that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enable me to deliver this message and enable you to understand it and follow it insha'Allah. Brothers and sisters, the Fariqah of Hajj, we always look at it as something optional, something extra, something whenever we get time, whenever we have nothing to do, we go ahead and do it. And this is not exactly what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala meant from us when it comes to the Fariqah of Hajj. That's why I always call it the most misunderstood Fariqah in Islam. Number one, because it is a Fariqah, I want you to know the meaning of a Fariqah. A Fariqah is the religious act that must be done immediately when you meet the minimum requirements for it. For example, Jum'ah is a Fariqah. When the time comes for Jum'ah and you are able to come to the masjid, you must come, and if you don't, you are guilty of violating that Fariqah. Fasting is in the month of Ramadan. When Ramadan comes and you are able to fast, if you do not fast, you are guilty of violating this Fariqah. Hajj is not just a Fariqah. Hajj is a Fariqah important enough to become one of the pillars of Islam. We have much more than the five pillars of Islam to be fara'id. But the most important five of those fara'id were chosen to be the pillars of Islam. So when you practice all the pillars of Islam, you will meet with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with a perfect religion like a perfect hand with five fingers. But if you meet with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, while your religion is only built upon four pillars instead of five, you will meet with a defected religion as a hand with four fingers. And normally, if you see someone with a hand of four fingers, you always ask, what happened? What happened to the fifth finger? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask you in the Day of Judgment, what happened to the fifth pillar of Islam? And you better have a good answer, because I know all your answers, we all have it. I was busy, I was this, I was that. That is not accepted, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you the answer for your answer already in the Quran by saying, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. Your main job in this life is to be a slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first, then second, whatever profession you have. So keep that in mind. Why do we call Hajj to be the most misunderstood Fariqah of Islam? Why? Number one, I can assure you that among the five pillars of Islam, or the five pillars that Islam is built upon, you are doing the first one with no doubt. All of you bear witness that there is no God but Allah, and Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. There is no doubt about that. That's why you are here. And all of you are praying. Alhamdulillah, you are here to pray. And those who pray, when Ramadan comes, they fast. Unless they have a good reason. And those who fast, pays their zakat. But I can assure you that a great number of us did not go to Hajj yet. Not only so, never thought about Hajj yet. Never thought about Hajj yet. But this is not what Allah meant. If Hajj is a farida and one of the pillars of Islam, all the fara'id are the responsibility of every able, adult, sane Muslim, male or female. So when you reach the adulthood in Islam, which is the puberty or the age of 15, whichever comes first, not 18, 15, whichever comes first, you are responsible, you are asked by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for your salah, for your zakah, for your fast, for your hajj as well. But at that age, maybe you are unable. Fine. If you have the excuse of not being able to go to hajj, you will have a good answer. But the problem is, we came from cultures that they taught us directly or indirectly that hajj is only for rich people. That's why very rarely you find a young man, a poor man or a poor woman going to hajj. We are under that impression that hajj is for all the people. That's why you never see a young 15 or 16 or 17 years old kid going to hajj. Something is wrong here. Why don't we go? Because they taught us that it is not that important. They said, لِمَنْ اسْتَطَاعَ إِلَيْهِ سَبِيلًا. And I took a long time last Saturday night to explain istata'. And I'm not going to go through this because that will take the rest of the khutbah. But istata' is the maximum effort. You do your maximum effort to go. If you are able, you must go. But if your maximum effort made you fail short of going, you have to try again. That is the meaning of istata'. Otherwise, you are not actually thinking. You are not responding to the call of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The first misunderstanding I mentioned, that people think it is for only for rich. But listen to the Quran. What did the Quran say about Hajj? Hajj was a farida since the time of Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam. And when Ibrahim built the Kaaba, after the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to build it, Allah told him to call people for Hajj. So Ibrahim said, how can my voice reach everyone? So Allah said, you make the call and I'll make the delivery. Just make the call. And when you make the call, I will guarantee you that the first people who will respond to the Hajj are the poor people. How is that? Said, وَأَذِّنْ فِي النَّاسِ بِالْحَجِّ يَأْتُوكَ رِجَالًا. They come to you walking. Why do they walk in the desert? Because they do not own a horse or a camel or a donkey. They do not even have the fare, the fees for transportation. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praised those people who will come to Ibrahim first, those who will come walking, the poor people. He said, they will come to you. Means to you means that you're going to see them, you're going to recognize them, because nobody else came before them. But when they become a big crowd, others will come riding. And he did not say, will come to you. They will come with every means of transportation from every area of this earth. So Allah said, the poor people will come first. But poverty also needs some ability. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave us the minimum ability for Hajj to be az-zadu wa rahila. The food supplies for yourself and your family during your absence for the trip of Hajj, and the means of transportation to go to Hajj. If you meet this minimum with your maximum efforts, not with convenience, you must go. And if you don't, you are guilty, you will be questioned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for not going to Hajj. So number one, because it is a farida, so it is for everyone, young and old. Number two, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, يَأْتُوكَ رِجَالًا, means the poor and the rich as well are required to go to Hajj if they are able. The minimum ability for Hajj is الزاد والراحلة. اليوم إن شاء الله نتحدث عن فريضة الحج وأهميتها. وقد تناولنا هذا الحديث في حديث السبت الماضي, ولكن غالبية الموجودين اليوم لم يكونوا حاضرين في ليلة السبت, وعزمنا أن نتحدث عن سوء الفهم في هذه الفريضة. جئنا من بيئات تجعلنا نظن أن الحج للكبار فقط, لذلك قلما تجد صغيرا يحج. وجئنا أيضا من بلاد علمتنا أن الحج للأغنياء فقط, لذلك قلما تجد فقيرا يحج. ولكن الله سبحانه وتعالى فرض الحج على كل مسلم بالغ قادر عاقل, ذكرا كان أم أنثى. فعندما يصل الإنسان إلى سن البلوغ فهو مطالب بكل فرائض الله, والحج ليس فقط فريضة ولكنه فريضة مهمة جدا لأن تكون أحد أعمدة الإسلام الخمس. فإذا طبقنا الدين كما يجب تلقى الله سبحانه وتعالى يوم القيامة ودينك كامل كيد بخمس أصابع. أما إذا مت ولم تحج فسيكون دينك ناقصا, وسيسألك الله سبحانه وتعالى. وأظن أن الأعذار التي نسمعها من كثير من المسلمين هي أعذار واهية, لأن الله سبحانه وتعالى يقول وما خلقت الجن والإنس إلا ليعبدون. إذن فالمهمة الرئيسية لخلق الإنسان والجان في هذا العالم هو عبادة الله سبحانه وتعالى. فعلينا أن نتقي الله سبحانه وتعالى, وعلينا أن نزيل سوء الفهم عن هذه الفريضة, وأن نحقق ما أراد الله سبحانه وتعالى منا أن نحقق بخلقنا في هذه الأرض, وجعلنا خليفة الله في أرضه أن نعبده وأن نوصل رسالته للآخرين. So dear brothers and sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made that Hajj to be that important. And some of the misunderstanding, beside being for the poor or the rich, the young or the old, there is something I'm not going to speak about today, because my main objective today is to show you the importance and make you go to Hajj this year inshallah if you can, or intend for as soon as possible, before it become too late. But the second part that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the ayah, وَأَذِّنْ فِي النَّاسِ بِالْحَجِّ يَأْتُوكَ رِجَالًا وَعَلَى كُلِّ ضَامِرٍ يَأْتِينَ مِنْ كُلِّ فَجٍّ عَمِيقٍ. They will come to you walking or riding. For what? First, لِيَشْهَدُوا مَنَافِعَ لَهُمْ. They are benefit that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala meant from that gathering. And unfortunately, most of us do not know what are those benefits. And we heard lots of people saying about very minor thing to be the benefit, but this is not what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala meant and put it even before the worship. لِيَشْهَدُوا مَنَافِعَ لَهُمْ وَيَذْكُرُوا اسْمَ اللَّهِ فِي أَيَّامٍ مَعْلُومَاتٍ. So the benefit was first, because to go and make the sa'i and the tawaf and wukuf, you can do that in Umrah, even though there is no wukuf. But you can go do most of the rituals in Umrah. But Allah wants you to go for Hajj, for something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from you. And that is beyond just sa'i and tawaf and wukuf. And in order for you to know exactly what are those manafa, inshallah, in the next khutbah, we will talk about the Hajj that happened at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How it was practiced. What are the benefits that they sought from this Hajj? Whether it was fulfilled or not. This is, we'll be talking about that inshallah. Because of the importance of that Hajj, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned that there will be a great punishment for those who ignore the faridah of Hajj. So he said, من لم يمنعه من الحج حاجة ظاهرة أو سلطان جائر أو مرض حابس ومات ولم يحج فليمت إن شاء يهوديا أو نصرانيا. The one who's not prevented from going to Hajj due to a dire need means poverty or a tyrant ruler or severe illness and die without going to Hajj. Let him die as he wishes, a Jew or a Christian. Is it that bad? Yes. Ali ibn Abi Talib said in the same regard, Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu wa karam Allahu wajh said in that regard, من ملك زادا وراحلة ولم يحج فليمت إن شاء يهوديا أو نصرانيا. The one who possesses Zad, food supplies, and a means of transportation to go to Hajj, yet not going to Hajj, let him die as he wishes, a Jew or a Christian. I am not declaring that you are a Jew or a Christian because you did not go to Hajj. I want you to know that Hajj is for us, not for the Jewish and the Christian people. It is for us and you have to go. And Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu also said in the same regard, I wish I can send people, messengers, to go search for those who own food supplies and means of transportation enough to go to Hajj and yet they are not going. To impose jizya instead of zakah on them, they are not Muslims, they are not Muslims, they are not Muslims. It is that important. Listen to the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَلِلَّهِ عَلَى النَّاسِ The right of Allah over the people. It is not easy. Allah mentioned His name first before you, because you owe Allah. It is the right of Allah over you. Whoever have the means to go, must go to Hajj. And he used the word مَنْ اسْتَطَاعَ إِلَيْهِ سَبِيلًا وَلِلَّهِ عَلَى النَّاسِ It is the right of Allah over people. حَجُّ الْبَيْتِ The Hajj of the Bayt of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it is a must and a farida for those who have a mean for it. A mean, not all the means. The problem that we are waiting to have all the means. We are not looking for one mean. We looked only for one mean to come from our country to here. Whenever we were able, we left everything. We left our mothers and our fathers, our properties and our businesses. We left our memories and our beautiful life. And we find the mean to come here, we came because we thought at that time that it is important to come. When you find a mean to get married, you do it. When you find a mean to go to the college, you do it. But when it comes to Hajj, Allah said one mean. We are looking for all the means. Wait until you finish the school. Wait until you get married. Wait until you have children. Wait until the children finish the school. Wait until your daughters get married. Then now you'll be 50 or 60, wait a few more years until you retire, then go and get that prestigious title so the people will call you Hajj. Majority of us are doing it this way. This is not what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala meant for Hajj to be. Because I scared you too much about that Hajj. Listen, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَلِلَّهِ عَلَى النَّاسِ حَجُّ الْبَيْتِ مَنْ اسْتَطَاعَ إِلَيْهِ سَبِيلًا Then he said what? وَمَنْ كَفَرْ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ غَنِيٌّ عَنِ الْعَالَمِينَ The first part of that ayah said that you owe that to Allah. But for those who reject faith by not going to Hajj, or those who reject that they owe that to Allah, or those who deny the right of Allah for that Hajj, Allah is self-sufficient and Allah the most dependent over the need of His people. So brothers, if you don't want to go to Allah, Allah doesn't want you either. But Allah wants you to go, that's why He called you. And you've been ignoring that farida every time. The call for Hajj is still current, because the Quran is still current. When Allah says, وَأَذِّنْ فِي النَّاسِ بِالْحَجِّ He's telling me to call you. He's telling you to call whoever. He's telling the father to call the children, and the mother to call her husband. He's ordering everyone to call people for Hajj. If the call is still current and is still valid, you are required by Allah to go But the fact, the sad fact, that we are ignoring that call to the point that I prescribed it once, the call of Allah become like the junk mail. Junk mail means that we do not even open the envelope to see whatever in it. We do not respond to the call of Allah. So since you are 15, Allah is calling you. And since then you've been ignoring it. And I'm sure in some of those years, you were able or unable. But the years at which you were able, you are guilty for not doing. That's why after 20, 30, 40, 50 years of neglecting the call of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when finally you decide to go, what is the first thing you do after you wear ihram? It's called in Arabic talbiyah. Talbiyah means respond to a call. Now you realize that Allah was calling you, and after this long time, you say labbaik. Like I said before, that the most polite response to a call in the Arabic literature is the word labbaik. You can call me and I say yes. You can call me and I say present. You can call me and I say here. But when you call me and I say labbaik, first, it means that I respect you enough. Second, I heard you. I understand you. I'm willing to listen to you. And when I listen, I'm willing to obey you. That's why when we go for Hajj, after that long neglection to the call of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we say labbaik Allahumma labbaik. Allah does not criticize you for denying him for all those years, like we do. But when you say labbaik, when you say labbaik Allahumma labbaik, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will respond to you and say labbaik wa sa'daik abdi. Labbaik wa sa'daik abdi. You approach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with a distance of a span of a hand. Allah approach you with a distance of a span of a heart. You come to Allah walking. Allah come to you jogging. And you walk to Allah with your own speed. You see how slow you are. Allah will come to you jogging by his own speed. So, go back. Do I have something good to tell you if you go back? Yes. Two beautiful hadith to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As you know, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made reasons for us to forgive our sins because he loves us. Then when he forgives our sins, inshallah, he will admit us to the Jannah. So Rasulullah said, between a salah and a salah, between a jum'ah and a jum'ah, between Ramadan and Ramadan, between Umrah and Umrah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala avoids all the sins in between if you perform those worships with sincerity to Allah. Between Dhuhr and Asr, Allah waive your sins. Between Jum'ah, last Jum'ah and this Jum'ah, Allah waive your sins. But some of them will leak out because you were not too sincere of performing those salah. Between Ramadan and Ramadan, same thing. Between Umrah and Umrah. But when it comes to Hajj, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, والحج المبرور ليس له جزاء إلا الجنة. الجنة معناها إيه؟ من الصلاة إلى الصلاة والجمعة إلى الجمعة ورمضان إلى رمضان والعمرة إلى العمرة كفارة لما بينهم، يعني تغفر فيها الذنوب. والحج المبرور ليس له جزاء إلا الجنة، يعني غفرت الذنوب وضمنت الجنة، يعني غفر ما تقدم وغفر أيضا ما تأخر إذا كان الحج مبرورا. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us that Allah will waive the sins between a salah and the other salah, between Jum'ah and the other Jum'ah, between Umrah and the other Umrah, between Ramadan and the other Ramadan. All the previous sins will be waived, will be taken away. But when it comes to Hajj, he said, but the sincere Hajj, al-Hajj al-Mabrur, have no other reward but the Jannah. It means that Allah forgives all of your previous sins and all of your coming sins, future sins, and guaranteed the Jannah for you if you go sincerely to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by performing the Fariidah of Hajj. There is another beautiful hadith that show you a word of some of the rituals you do when you intend to go to Hajj. Give me just a minute to say it in Arabic. It's a long hadith, then I'll try my best in English, inshallah. Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu قال بينما كنا جلوسا عند رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم في مسجد منى إذ دخل علينا رجلان أحدهما من ثقيف والآخر من الأنصار فسلم على الرسول وقال يا رسول الله جئنا نسألك يعني نسألك سؤالا فقال الرسول إن شئتما أنصتما وأخبركما عما جئتما تسألاني عنه وإن شئتما أنصت أنا وتسألاني فقال الثقفي للأنصاري سل اسأل فقال الأنصاري الذي يريد يعني أن يقوي دينه فقال لا بل أنت يا رسول الله أخبرنا عن السؤال وأخبرنا عن الإجابة أخبرنا عن السؤال وأخبرنا عن الإجابة فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم جئت تسألني عن خروجك من بيتك تأم المسجد الحرام يعني في الحج وما لك فيه أي من الأجر وجئت تسألني عن ركعتيك بعد الطواف أي طواف القدوم وما لك فيه وجئت تسألني عن سعيك بين الصفا والمروة وما لك فيه وجئت تسألني عن وقوفك عشية عرفة وما لك فيه وجئت تسألني عن نحرك وما لك فيه وجئت تسألني عن حلقك وما لك فيه وجئت تسألني عن رميك الجمار وما لك فيه وجئت تسألني عن طوافك مع الإفاضة وما لك فيه فقال السائل والله يا رسول الله لعن هذا جئنا نسأل هو ده بالضبط اللي احنا جينا نسألك عنه فأجاب الرسول قال أما خروجك من بيتك تأم المسجد الحرام فلا ترفع ناقتك خفا ولا تضعه حتى يعطيك الله حسنة ويمحو عنك خطيئة أما ركعتيك بعد الطواف فكعتق رقبة مؤمنة من ولد إسماعيل عليه السلام وأما سعيك بين الصفا والمروة كعتق 70 رقبة في الإسلام وأما وقوفك عشية عرفة فإن الله يتنزل إلى السماء الدنيا ويباهي بكم الملائكة ويقول انظروا عبادي جاءوني شعثا غبرا من كل فج يرجون رحمتي ويخافون عذابي فوعزتي وجلالي لو كانت ذنوبكم مثل زبد البحر أو عدد حبات المطر أو عدد الرمل لغفرتها لكم أفيضوا مغفورا لكم ولمن شفعتم له أما رميك الجمرات فبكل حصاة ترميها خطيئة من الموبقات وأما نحرك فمدخور لك عند ربك ليوم القيامة وأما حلقك فبكل شعرة تحلقها تأخذ بها حسنة وتحط عنك خطيئة وأما طوافك مع الإفاضة فإنك تطوف ولا ذنب عليك ثم يأتي ملك ويضع يده على كتفيك ويقول لك يا عبد الله اعمل فيما يستقبل فقد غفر الله لك كل ما مضى ده حديث which I said in Arabic sounds so beautiful in Arabic. Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu narrated while we were sitting with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Masjid Mina. Two men appeared on us. They greeted the Prophet and they said, we came to ask you, mean to ask a question. Rasulullah said, if you wish you could be silent, and I will tell you about the question you intend to ask me and the answers for those questions. Or if you wish, I could be silent and you ask me. So the man of Thaqif told the man of Ansar, these are the two men appeared before the Prophet, asked. So the man of Ansar want to affirm his faith in Allah and his Rasulullah. And he said, no, O Prophet of Allah, just tell us. Tell us about the questions we intend to ask you, and tell us also about the answers. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, you came to ask me about leaving your home, proceeding toward Al-Masjid Al-Haram for Hajj, and what is the reward for that? You came to ask me about the two rak'ah that you do after the first tawaf, and what is the reward for that? You came to ask me about sa'i between Safa and Marwa, and what is the reward for that? You came to ask me about standing on the Mount of Arafat in the day of Arafat, and what is the reward for that? You came to ask me about throwing the stones, and what is the reward for that? You came to ask me about the animal sacrifices that you offer to Allah, and what is the reward for that? You came to ask me about shaving your head, and what is the reward for that? You came to ask me about your final tawaf, and what is the reward for that? They said, by Allah, these are the exact questions we intend to ask you. So Rasulullah gave him the answer and said, leaving your home, proceeding toward Al-Masjid Al-Haram for the intention of Hajj, whenever your camel left her foot or put it down, Allah will give you a hasanah and remove a khatiyah. And for the two rak'ah that you do after the first tawaf, you will be rewarded as if you free a slave from the children of Prophet Ismail alayhi salam. And for sa'i between Safa and Marwa, you get a reward as if you free 70 slaves in Islam. And for standing in the night of Arafat, Allah will descend down to the first heaven and become proud of you before the angels and tell them, look at my servant. They came from everywhere, with shoveled hair and dusty faces. They are seeking my mercy and forgiveness. They are fearing my punishment. By my majesty and honor, if your sins are as big as the foam of the running ocean, or as much as the drops of the rain, or the grains of the sand, I will forgive it all for you, and for whom you ask forgiveness. Leave with my forgiveness. And for throwing the stones, for everyone you throw, Allah will forgive one of the great kaba'ir, the destructive sins. And for the animal sacrifice that you offer to Allah, Allah will save the reward of that to the day of judgment, while you are the neediest for that reward. And for shaving your head, for every hair you shave, Allah will give you a hasanah and remove a sayyah. And when it comes to the final tawaf, you make that tawaf and there are no sins against you. And an angel will come and put his hand over your shoulder and say, my servant, do good for your future. Indeed, Allah has forgiven all of your previous sins. These are some of the rewards that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you if you go. When you recognize and you realize your neglection to the call of Allah, Allah's not going to criticize you, Allah's not going to yell at you, but you go to Him, He will come back to you. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم. الحمد لله رب العالمين ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله ولي الصالحين وأن محمدا عبده ورسوله إمام المتقين. أما بعد, dear brothers and sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make those worships as reasons to forgive you because He loves you. He wants you to be in the Jannah. He doesn't want any blames or any punishment for you. When you go to Hajj and you wear the Ihram, that will bring you a memory of your beginning and your end. That brings you a memory in the day at which you were born, when they wrapped you up in a piece of cloth. Most likely it's white piece. And also when you die and they will wrap you up in a piece of cloth. Most likely also it is white. When you go to Hajj, you wrap up yourself with a piece of cloth similar to the day, to the clothes of death than it is to the clothes of life. The difference between wearing ihram when you are in Hajj versus wearing what they clothed you when you were born or when you die. When you die, you will come to this life with nothing, naked, barefooted. I mean, when you come to this life, and when you die, same thing will happen. And when you go to Hajj, you're going to practice that at least momentarily. When you were born, you know nothing and you cannot do anything. When you die, you know everything that you possibly can know, but you cannot do anything. When you go to Hajj, you know everything that you possibly can know, and you are able to do everything within your own maximum ability. That's why when you go to Hajj, leaving everything behind, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants something from this gathering to benefit this nation. Wants something to make this nation like it meant for it to be. خَيْرَ أُمَّةٍ أُخْرِجَتْ لِلنَّاسِ. The nation that command all of that which is right and forbid all of that which is wrong and believe sincerely in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We will inshallah, if we have more time to live, we will talk about after wearing ihram and going for Hajj, what does Allah expect from the 2 or 3 or 5 millions who left everything behind, who left their family, their wealth, everything, and there were a clause similar to the clause of death, and finally said to Allah, labbaik Allahumma labbaik. Now here I am and Allah want to give you the orders. Why did He call you? He called you for benefit? We want to talk about those benefits inshaAllah. ختاما لحديث اليوم فعندما تستجيب لنداء الله سبحانه وتعالى بعد طول صمت وتجاهل وتقول لبيك اللهم لبيك وتلبس الإحرام يذكرك الإحرام بيوم بدايتك ويوم نهايتك. يوم أن ولدت حافيا عاريا لا تملك شيئا. يوم أن لفوك في خرقة بيضاء. ويوم أن تموت وأيضا تنزع عنك ملابسك ويلفونك في خرقة بيضاء. في الحج أنت الذي تنزع الملابس وأنت الذي تلبس الخرقة البيضاء. يوم ولدت ولدت وأنت لا تدري شيئا ولا تقدر على شيء. ويوم أن مت أنت تعرف كل شيء ولكن لا تقدر على أي شيء. أما وأنت في الحج فتعرف كل شيء وتقدر على كل شيء. وبعد أن قلت لبيك ناداك الله فقلت نعم أنا هنا، الله سيقول لك ماذا تفعل وسيهديك مغفرته وعفوه وجنته إن شاء الله. اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين وأعل بفضلك كلمتي الحق والدين.
آمين.
اللهم زدنا ولا تنقصنا يا رب العالمين.
آمين.
اللهم من أراد بالإسلام خيرا فوفقه يا رب العالمين.
آمين.
ومن أراد به شرا فدمره وأهلكه يا رب العالمين.
آمين.
اللهم اغفر ذنوبنا.
آمين.
وإسرافنا في أمرنا.
آمين.
وثبت أقدامنا.
آمين.
وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين.
آمين.
اللهم انصر المستضعفين المسلمين في كل مكان يا رب العالمين.
آمين.
وخصوصا في سوريا الجريحة.
آمين.
وفي كل مكان آخر في هذه الأرض يا رب العالمين.
آمين.
اللهم من أراد بالإسلام خيرا فوفق.
آمين.
ومن أراد به شرا فدمره وأهلك.
آمين.
اللهم أدخلنا الجنة بغير حساب.
آمين.
اللهم أدخلنا الجنة مع النبيين والصديقين والشهداء والصالحين وحسن أولئك رفيقا.
آمين.
عباد الله، إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. اذكروا الله العظيم يذكركم، واستغفروه يغفر لكم، وأقم الصلاة.